Good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the 22nd meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to agree or not to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. The principal item on our agenda this morning is a consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's briefing on Scotland's colleges 2022. So can I welcome our witnesses in the committee room this morning, Auditor General Stephen Boyle, Carolyn MacLeod, Audit Director, Performance, Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland, and Mark McCabe, who's an Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. You're all very welcome here, and Auditor General, as you know, feel free to bring in your supporting wing members at the points that you find most useful, that would be most enlightening for the committee. But could I ask you to kick us off by giving us a short opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, committee. I welcome the opportunity to speak to you this morning about Scotland's college sector. Scotland's colleges play a vital role in helping people learn new skills and fulfil their potential. They also make significant contributions to supporting economic development at a local and national level. In recent years, we have reported on the challenges faced by the college sector, including responding to risks of financial sustainability and focusing on improving outcomes for Scotland's students. These pressures continue with anticipated challenging financial settlements in future for colleges. My latest briefing focuses on the 2020-21 academic year. It highlights that Scotland's colleges responded well to COVID-19 and that additional funding contributed to a better than expected financial outturn for the year. However, colleges' financial position is now expected to deteriorate, with deficits forecast in 21-22 and 22-23. The Scottish Government's multi-year spending plans announced in May show a flat cash settlement, a real terms reduction for the Scottish Funding Council over the next 4 years, indicating some really challenging times for the sector. The COVID-19 pandemic had a detrimental impact on learning and student outcomes. The proportion of full-time further education students successfully completing their course and achieving the intended qualifications fell in 2021. And on average, socially disadvantaged and vulnerable students are still less likely to complete their courses than their peers. The varied impact of the pandemic across different groups of students has exacerbated existing inequalities. Changes are needed to ensure the sector is financially sustainable in the long term and more students successfully complete their courses. The Scottish Funding Council made a series of wide-ranging recommendations to improve the further and higher education sector in 2021. The Scottish Government and the Funding Council are starting to take forward these recommendations. They have prioritised work to set out the future role of the college and university sector by May of next year and to develop their national impact framework to assess outcomes by August 2023. In the meantime, the Scottish Government and the Funding Council need to consider how best to support colleges to prepare and plan for these changes now. It is important that they clarify expectations and priorities for the sector over the medium and long term and the funding that is available to deliver them. Convener, as ever, my colleagues and I will do our utmost to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, and we've got questions which touch on all of those areas that you've outlined in your opening statement, so that's very, very helpful in setting the scene. Two of the most striking expressions which are used in the report are that the finances are healthier than expected, but it's clear that there is still a precarious financial position which Scotland's colleges are in. I wonder if you could say a little bit more about healthier than expected. I mean, so colleges are viewed by many people as public sector institutions, and most public sector institutions were not eligible to qualify for the job retention scheme, furlough monies, for example, or for other COVID grants which were available to businesses. Could you explain a little bit more about how it came to pass that Scotland's colleges drew down on this money to such an extent that you offer this as an explanation about their financial position being rosier than might otherwise have been expected?
Yeah, I'm happy to cover all those points, Convener, and I'll bring Mark in a moment to say a bit more about the college sector and their status and how that allowed access to some of the UK government's financial support arrangements. In terms of the overall conclusion, the healthier than expected, as I mentioned in the opening statement, we've seen some of the financial challenges that Scotland's colleges have been experiencing in previous years. And also in the context of the impact that COVID was expected to have, not just in colleges, but other public bodies, and relating that in particular to their access to other sources of income, commercial income that Scotland's colleges, and that has been reducing and was reduced further as a result of the pandemic. So weighing all of those factors brought us to a point that it was expected that there would be a real squeeze on Scotland's colleges in the year in question. COVID monies, though, helped secure their financial position. And Mark can explain a bit more of that in a moment. But before handing over, perhaps to say about the longer-term outlook. Scotland's colleges are well-versed in preparing longer-term forecasts. And they've continued to do that, which is welcome, to set out their medium-term expectations. The next 2 years, the financial academic year just passed, and next year, suggest that the sector is going to return to an operating deficit before returning to a small surplus. And looking at the scale of movement, it does indicate that there are real financial stresses for Scotland's college sector that they will need to plan with the Funding Council and with their own organisations to think about options for how they might best respond and deliver their services. And we've seen, as I touched on in my opening statement, all of that will be within the context of flat cash settlements for the Funding Council, real terms cuts. So there's a real preparedness required now for how they'll be financially sustainable in the future. Convener, I'll pause and bring Mark in if I may, and then happy to elaborate further as you wish.
Okay. So in response, Convener, to your question about how they qualified for the coronavirus job retention scheme, I suppose they're a bit of an anomaly. Although they are classed as public bodies, not all of their income is provided as public income. So they have other sources of income. And because of that technicality, they were entitled to apply through the scheme. So they got funding to cover their staffing costs through that. But they also received additional COVID funding from the SFC, and that all contributed to that healthier balance that the Auditor General's referred to.
Thanks. I mean, you mentioned about real terms cuts and so on, and it struck me that that's presumably based on a multi-year forecast of what inflation is going to be, and that's a bit of a stab in the dark, isn't it? I mean, at the moment, the retail price index is over 12%. So in the context of the multi-year funding award, we could potentially be looking at quite a drastic real terms cut in funding.
Yes, yeah, so it's both those things, Convener, I guess, in terms of the resource spending review sets out from May. And, you know, and events have moved on with real pace since then. But it indicated at that point it would be a flat cash settlement for the Funding Council. What that means in terms of individual budget allocations for colleges will be derived over the course of the next few months through the Parliament's own scrutiny of the budget and then the SFC's own determinations. But yes, you know, inflation will be a real pressure for Scotland's colleges. And regardless of whatever the retail or price index or the consumer price index is, not necessarily be the cost drivers that individual colleges are facing. We touched on in the report that 70% of Scotland's colleges' cost base or thereabouts is staff costs. So whatever the pay award settlement they reach with their trade union representatives will inform and influence their overall spending arrangements. So there are a number of variables at play that will indicate how Scotland's colleges individually will have to manage their resources next year.
I'm going to bring Colin Beattie in a second, but there's just one other area I wanted to have a look at the start, which is Brexit. I mean, there has been have been periods in the past where Scotland's colleges have been able to draw on European social funds and other streams of support from the European Union, which is clearly no longer available, or at least it's been tapered out of the system completely. In its place, we are offered the UK Shared Prosperity Fund. I mean, Is that going to find its way through to Scotland's colleges in the way European Union funds did? Or given that that's likely to be administered or going to local authorities, what's the expectation of that money reaching the further education sector?
I'll turn to colleagues to see if there's anything they can support. Convener, we haven't covered that in great deal of detail in this paper today about the range of funding arrangements that colleges have used. I've mentioned in passing other income, and that being one of the sources that is no longer what it was. Still opportunities, though, for colleges to review arrangements, recover where possible. And you're right that European funding was also one of those sources. Colleges need to review their entire arrangements, whether it's European funding, commercial income, the staff cost, to ensure their financial sustainability. Their access to the successor to European funding arrangements, the Shared Prosperity Fund or others, is just part of those arrangements. But undoubtedly, that and along these other cost pressures suggest that, as they've suggested themselves in their own forecast, it's going to be really tough times. If colleagues wish to say anything further, Mark?
I'm not sure there's a lot I can add to that, but in terms of the European Social Fund, it was in place for the year that we were looking at, so that it has continued on post-Brexit. I think 2021 was the last year that it was available to colleges. And to access European social funding, colleges have to hit their core core target allocation, if you like, for students. So obviously COVID has had an impact on how they've been able to do that. And the European Social Fund is over and above on top of that once they've reached the threshold of their core targets. So I guess what we'll have to see is what that looks like in the current academic year once that social funding is no longer available, how they are achieving their current targets and how they're getting back up to speed post-COVID and, the flow of students through the system.
Fine, okay. Okay, well, I'm going to move things on now and invite Colin Beattie to ask some questions about the financial sustainability of the sector. Colin.
Thanks, Convener. Auditor General, this question of sustainability within the college sector goes back a very long way now, and it's in various iterations over the years, particularly since 2014. You've said about, and there's been a brief discussion on COVID-related funding, which is masking some of the problems in the financial situation. Can you quantify that at all, what the impact has been of the... I'm trying to get to the underlying financial situation as opposed to the COVID funding, which is impacting.
Good morning, Mr. Beattie. To agree with you, you're right. It's not news from Audit Scotland that Scotland's college sector has been dealing with financial sustainability issues for a number of years. COVID has played a significant contributor. I think, as the convener mentioned, that healthier than expected, which does speak to your point that actually that additional money supported the sector in the academic financial year in question. Mark can say a bit more if he's able to about just the volume of COVID-related monies that the sector brought in. But if I may just draw the committee's attention to Exhibit 1 in the paper that refers to the challenges that the sector is anticipating by way of its financial sustainability in the 21-22 and 22-23. So we see in the year past, the year that the report relates to, of nearly a £20 million operating surplus position that is anticipated to change to deficits in the two subsequent years. And as is set out in the paper, Mr. Beattie, that COVID-related monies were a significant contributor to supporting the financial position. As we speak in the paper, it matters now that there's that analysis, review of financial plans, positions of all the colleges, but also, therefore, the role that the funding council expects colleges to play through the delivery of their work. I'll pause for a moment, Mr. Beattie, and just see if Mark can share that precise number with you, and then I'm happy to answer anything further.
In terms of numbers, we've set out in the report that the sector received an additional £15 million from the funding council in terms of COVID funding during the last academic year, 2021, and they also received almost £10 million through the furlough scheme, for a better word. I don't think it's necessarily appropriate to say if you add those two figures together, then you know that shows the difference in terms of the impact it's had, because obviously colleges have been adjusting to the situation they've found themselves in, so they've been trying to cut their cloth accordingly. They're trying to continuously make efficiencies. You know, they've changed their provision. So there's a lot of things in there. And as the Auditor General said earlier, they've lost things like commercial income over that period. So I don't think it's necessarily a straight linear calculation to say this is what they got in terms of the additional funding, and that's been the impact on their position. It's a slightly more complex picture than that.
Just looking at the SFC funding, it's a bit alarming that it's gone up since 2017-18 from 75 to now 79% in the period we're looking at. It was never intended that should be the case, that colleges should be generating some of their own income. And indeed they do, but it doesn't appear to be at the level that was anticipated pre-COVID.
So I think in terms of the percentage of the sector funding that comes through Scottish Funding Council grant, you're right, it has gone up. And actually, if you look back at the reports we've produced over many years, that number has crept up each year. And I think if you go back to something like 2013-14, it was about 71%, and as you say, it's now up to 79%. We did see an increase whereby through national bargaining, where we saw the increase in staff costs associated with that, the Funding Council agreed to fund that increase through Scottish Government funding. So that invariably put the costs up. They have lost things like commercial income through COVID, and, you know, trying to generate additional commercial income in the current environment is incredibly difficult. And I think that's where the percentage figure shifts. And it's been a noticeable shift.
Now, previously, there was a wide variety of financial situations among the individual colleges, particular issues around the Highland ones and issues with some of the Glasgow ones and so on. Is that still prevailing to that without much change? In other words, if we looked at 2018-19 and backwards and looked at it now, would we see the same pattern with the same colleges, or has there been any significant improvement with any of the colleges?
So you're right, there is, Mark can say a bit more about the detail behind that, but the overall picture you described remains the case. There is a wide variation in the individual financial sustainability of some colleges compared to others. Some colleges are producing £1 million surpluses. They have, some of the Glasgow colleges in particular, still have access to reducing funds nonetheless, but for the arm's length foundations that they were able to draw on. Not to the extent that it would have been at the start, as you said, a decreasing level of resource therein. But at the other end of the spectrum, there are some Scotland's colleges that have produced deficits. And that speaks to a real variety of challenges. Some of it will be informed by the nature of their student base, their ability to attract courses or students to attend courses and so forth. But that picture is not one of uniformity across the sector, Mr. Beattie. Mark may have some examples he wants to share with the committee.
No specific examples on individual colleges off the top of my head, I have to say. But what we see is colleges operate to tight margins. And what we might see is within any particular year, there'll be fluctuation where a college might find itself in a deficit one year, but then return to a small surplus the next year. And it can bounce around along that line. There's some colleges that are predicting surpluses over the next 3 to 5 years. There's some colleges that are predicting deficits over the next 3 to 5 years. So there is variation. What we have done is, alongside this report on our website, we have produced a suite of interactive data, and that allows people to interrogate by individual college to see, you know, the position that each college is in and the, where it's predicted to be in the next year.
Back in 2014, when the ALFs were formed, the theory was that, you know, probably optimistic in those days, that the commercial income would be parked in the ALFs and drawn down against specific contracts as time went on. There doesn't seem to be much evidence, really, that that has been a terribly successful strategy, and it seems to me, and please confirm or otherwise, that the ALFs are a dying breed, and as the current funding that they got in 2014 dies, so they will become no support for the colleges.
So, I think I would recognise that characterisation, yes. And again, much like a conversation on your last question, that wasn't a universal picture across Scotland, the scale of ALFs. You know, some colleges had very significant reserves that they were able to put into ALFs in the first place, others not so. But yes, they have dwindled. So there isn't the scale of resource available to colleges now to support their activities. And as we've mentioned already, commercial income is also dropping in Scotland's colleges, particularly exacerbated by the pandemic. Not to say, Mr. Beattie, that, you know, that especially with the scale of financial challenges set out by in the resource spending review, that that isn't an avenue that colleges can return to and bring new dynamism, opportunity to support their funding they receive from the funding council. But yes, it's not the scale of resource that they once had.
Why is it that with three of the Glasgow colleges, two-thirds of the money in ALFs relate to them? Is that just historical, or is there something behind it? Why are they more successful?
It's typically a legacy issue. As you'll be aware, the ALFs were created in 2014 when incorporated colleges achieved their new status, and they were no longer allowed to hold reserves. So all the reserves that the previous colleges had went into ALFs. So it depended on the level of reserves that each institution had at that time. And it just so happens that, as you've seen, we expected the level of that ALF pot to deteriorate over time as institutions drew on those legacy reserves. And as you see, you know, it's gone down from that initial 99 million to down to 19 million now. But we have seen that steady drop each year. And yes, it's just the legacy issue is the fact that the bulk of that is within those Glasgow colleges because they had the bulk of that at the start.
Just looking again at Exhibit 1, it shows that the SFC is forecasting that the adjusted operating position of colleges that in 2021-22 there was a deficit of 5.8 million, deficit again in 22-23 projected, and then it moves into surplus in 23-24, which seems positive. But how realistic is that? Is it achievable?
So we're not able to give you assurance one way or the other on those numbers. These are forecasts that the college sector has worked with the SFC to prepare. Looking back at the trend, if I may, it's still a very low projected surplus compared to the 3 years prior to the pandemic, and historically a much thinner margin that the sector is operating to than they would have done. And of course, margins of that scale spread across all of Scotland's colleges suggest that more will be experiencing really tight financial challenges, even if it is suggesting a surplus. And back to the convener's earlier point, with the number of variables that, you know, public bodies will be dealing with, you know, inflationary pressures, funding environment, pay awards requirements, all of that would suggest that an overall £2 million surplus is thin to be spread across the sector. So welcome return to surplus, but I'm not sure that we could say with confidence at this stage that that will be the figure that the sector will be dealing with.
Again, just final area to look at. Expenditure 2021 shows staff costs at 71% of the total, which is high, but of course it is very much a staff-driven environment there. I mean, people have to be able to present the courses and so on. So 71%, although it's high compared maybe to other areas, is possibly justified there. But it does mean that there is very limited manoeuvrability to save money elsewhere. And staff numbers fell in 2021 by 1.2%. Now, how sustainable are these staff numbers given the financial pressures against the colleges when the colleges really only have staff numbers to play with to save money?
You're right. The nature of the services that Scotland's colleges provide are a staff resource-intensive operation. So there's no surprise that it hovers around that number. And even looking back at the trend to the middle of the last decade suggests that there hasn't been a great deal of movement in staff numbers. It's there or there around the 70% number of staffing. But as you describe, Mr. Beattie, that with staffing numbers of that level, it means there are less options available to colleges to manage their financial position. We've mentioned already this morning that staff cost pressures will be a factor that colleges will have to deal with in balancing their budgets. And it means, therefore, all the more reason where they're able to look at other sources of income, in terms of whether it's European funding successor arrangements, their own commercial activities, and then also looking at their cost base as well. Are there efficiencies that Scotland's colleges can generate? Are there arrangements that they can share services with one another that will deliver efficiencies? So not for me to suggest particular things that they should focus on, but I think it's inevitable that all of Scotland's colleges will be looking ever more closely at their financial position, even more so than they're already doing.
We've been talking about shared resources now for as long as I can remember, and I'm not sure to the extent to which that's been successful. Are you aware of any examples of colleges that have found alternative ways to reduce costs or increase income? Is there a success story out there that might lead other colleges?
I'll ask colleagues, actually, if there's any examples they really want to share with the committee. But it's not just colleges that haven't moved in terms of sharing services quickly enough. This would be a representation across many parts of the public sector. But particularly for me, referencing back to the resource spending review that the government produced in May, there are references therein to efficiencies that we needed, digitalisation that's anticipated that will deliver some of the efficiencies required to support Scotland's fiscal position. The estates that Scotland's public bodies operate are also part of that factor. So there's a real need for looking at all aspects of the cost base, the asset base, and income generation arrangements to support financial position, including sharing of services where appropriate for bodies within the same sector and beyond the boundaries of a sector. So I don't think it's just a case of Scotland's colleges who want to share with one another where appropriate, and it makes sense, whether on a local or regional basis, there would be opportunities to do so as well. Carolyn, may I have an example to support your question, Mr. Beattie?
Yes, thank you. I don't have a specific example as such, but I'm just thinking about the broader context within which the colleges are operating and the purpose and principles that the Scottish Government are going to be developing. And that will support colleges, I suppose, to think about prioritisation, which I think inevitably is going to be a critical factor in their future planning. And likewise, the National Impact Framework, once it's produced by the SFC, will be a helpful tool, hopefully, in assessing the effect of changes that colleges have made. So both of those strategic developments will hopefully help colleges when they're thinking about their future planning. And support them to assess whether what they're doing is having the desired effect in terms of cost cutting, but also maintaining the volume, quality, breadth of learning that they're delivering.
Thank you, Mina.
Okay, thank you very much. So the figures around the financial sustainability of the sector do ring some alarm bells, and we've heard that already. One of the other areas covered in the briefing, which I think also is a cause for concern, are some of the figures that you've produced around student outcomes. And Sharon Dow is going to ask some questions on that subject.
Thank you. Good morning. It's noted that the number of students successfully completing their course and achieving a qualification has fallen. And according to surveys carried out by the Scottish Government and NUS Scotland, student poverty could be a contributing factor. You've also highlighted that this represents a risk not only for individual students, but also for public investment and value for money. So in your view, do we have enough information to rigorously assess the reasons why students are not completing their courses?
I'll bring Carolyn in a second, Ms. Dowie, on this point, but the paper today looks to explore not just the spending, but actually what's being achieved from it, and you know, consistent with many of our reports, what outcomes is actually being delivered for public investment. So the pandemic has had an impact on the experience that students have had and a contributing factor to those students completing their courses. And a headline we do report that it has exacerbated inequalities and also impacted on the number of students completing their courses. Referring to Exhibit 4, if I may, just looking at some of the analysis of different students, you can see from the trend, but particularly focusing on the last 2 years, between 2019-20 and 2020-21, we have seen a reduction in the rates of students completing their courses across different groups of society. And that's perhaps not unexpected, but still troubling nonetheless. And a real focus, therefore, for Scotland's colleges to think about how they are supporting their students, you know, if it's in a hybrid setting or a return to class-based learning, so that people get the outcomes that they want and that public investment gets the intended return for, you know, better outcomes for Scotland students. I'll pause for a moment and bring Carolyn in. I think she wants to say a bit more of this.
Yes, thank you. In terms of specific data about students who aren't successfully completing their courses, the challenge with that and understanding the reasons for the failure to complete courses is that where students go after they leave or after they withdraw is not tracked. Therefore, understanding their reasons for leaving isn't something that there's a lot of evidence about. But more broadly, there is information and feedback that certainly the introduction of remote learning did bring some positives in terms of flexibility, and that could be particularly helpful for students who had additional responsibilities, such as caring responsibilities. So there have been some advantages that have potentially arisen as a result of the pandemic. But on the other hand, there have been challenges in terms of poverty, you know, so digital poverty, for example, and that doesn't just extend to the technical equipment, but also somebody maybe not having a quiet space at home where they can study in peace, maybe not having great connectivity, for example. So there are lots of factors that fall under that umbrella, and the SFC have invested money to try and support students who might be experiencing digital poverty. And then we've also, you know, we're aware that particular courses, obviously there were challenges around practical courses and the completion of those given the social distancing requirements that were in place. But there are other factors that would have arisen as a result of the pandemic. For example, medical issues if people were suffering from COVID, if they had caring responsibilities maybe for relatives or others that they have responsibilities for who had issues due to COVID. And then mental health, of course, would have been another risk that might have been exacerbated in those circumstances. So there are lots of factors in the mix, but in terms of definitive information about the withdrawal rate, we don't have that.
Do you think we're doing enough to support students that are thinking of withdrawing from courses?
Well, certainly there are examples in the report of what colleges have tried to do to offer support. So, for example, one of the case studies outlines the food poverty initiative by one college to provide hot meals to students to try and encourage them, draw them into the campus and also make sure that they weren't going hungry. And there are other examples about, I suppose, efforts to involve students, include students, in a way that we'd encourage them to continue with their studies. So that's, as I say, there is anecdotal evidence there, but I'm not sure how much further detail I can provide in terms of the extent of the support across the board in colleges.
Ms. Now, if you just maybe just to supplement what Carolyn was saying about the analysis around positive destinations that colleges have, and looking at the exhibit, so it's just over 15% of people who left a college course were either unemployed or unavailable for work. Actually, but the reasons behind that matters. I know the committee's long-standing interest in data is a very relevant factor here. Colleges do have a pastoral role as well for students, you know, so that they understand how they're performing, so that they can anticipate people not completing their course, what the reasons behind that. And it's that data that allows them to make amendments, whether it's pastoral support, course content, overall access arrangements. So it's a real encouragement that we would make, actually, is that for colleges to look further at this, to better understand the reasons behind why students haven't completed their course or moved on to positive destination.
Thank you on that. So in Exhibit 3, it shows college leaver destinations in 2019-20, highlights a growing number of college leavers going to university, a 10% reduction in college leavers going into work, and in addition, 15.6% of college leavers, just as you've mentioned there, are unemployed or unavailable to work, a 3% increase from 2018 and 19. What's your assessment of the value for money delivered by Scotland's colleges in light of leaver destinations?
Leaver destination would be one factor that would inform an overall value for money judgment on Scotland's colleges. Not something we've attempted to do in this paper today. But clearly, you know, for public investment, for the outcomes for individual students, that we can assume that not all of those, and it is an assumption I should say, not all of the 15% embarked on a college course with the expectation that they would be unemployed after it, given that we've talked about that colleges play a vital role in supporting students acquiring new skills, supporting employability aspirations or further learning. So that number feels too high to have embarked upon a college course and then not complete it. And it goes back to their earlier discussion, therefore, that colleges need to get better data behind why this is happening to support, yes, you rightly say, about public investment, but also the individual experience and then subsequent life chances for people who've embarked on a college course.
I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey shortly, but can I just compare and contrast two of the statistics which are in your briefing on that subject? Because on the one hand, we've got student satisfaction rate amongst full-time students at a very high 88%. But then the line above that tells us that 27% of full-time FE students withdrew, dropped out. So, I mean, I can only assume that the students surveyed under the satisfaction survey did not include those who had withdrawn.
Unless colleagues tell me different, I'm not sure we know the precise scope of the various surveys, but those numbers do look at odds with one another as to overall satisfaction and withdrawal rates. I think there is real merit in getting beneath some of that, but I'm not sure we have that information today.
Okay, and I think it might be in part as a result of the timing that different surveys are carried out as well. Anyway, Mark McCabe is nodding at that point. Okay, I'm going to now ask Willie Coffey to come in, who's got some more questions in this area. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, everyone, again. I think one of the few good things that emerged from COVID was how quickly the colleges, and particularly Ayrshire College, I have to mention, Convener, adapted to the circumstances that they found themselves in. And it was really a credit, I think, to the staff and to the students about how quickly they responded and adapted to the new world that they lived in, the online world, in effect, which almost sprang on us overnight. And so there were some fantastic examples, Auditor General, of this, and you mention a couple in your briefing, but you also talk about the impact, the equalities impact, that Sharon Dowie mentioned too. So would you kindly tell us a little bit about that experience, the positive way that the colleges embraced the online world to try to address the clear impact that it was having in making inequalities even worse?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Coffey. It is all of those things, the pandemic. And you know, as we've spoken on a number of occasions with the committee, both the drive for innovation that the pandemic brought about, and some organisations responded better than others in terms of, you know, changing the way that they delivered services. And that's true of Scotland's colleges as well. Carolyn can come in a moment and to support the committee with to some of the examples that we have in the report. But perhaps maybe just for cite one of the references that we make about the assessment that not us, but HMI inspectors from Education Scotland made of Scotland's colleges, that particularly around remote and digital learning, that was developed at pace and in a number of different practical ways. So that there is validated evidence out there to say that colleges responded to support students. And that's really welcome. I remember, if I mean, the round table that the committee held last year, where, you know, you took evidence from this, and the contributor from the National Union of Students gave some examples around this, about some examples where it had worked well and others where it had remained really challenging. And that, of course, is influenced by people's individual circumstances, the support they're receiving from their colleges, what their home environments are like, and how all that. So inevitably, that will bring a real degree of variability. But it is welcome, nonetheless, to that validation that Education Scotland suggests about the pace with which change took place. You mentioned inequalities and some of the variability, so I'm going to pause at the moment and invite Carolyn to cover that point. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, in terms of the inequalities, we've already touched on some of those points in my earlier response, but certainly, yeah, a focus on funding to ensure that digital poverty wasn't an inhibitor to students engaging was a key step that was taken by the SFC in these circumstances. I think as well the pandemic really has shone a light on mental health issues and the importance of there being appropriate support in that area. So you can see from one of the case studies in the report that most colleges have tried to introduce some sort of mental health support for their students. So while that doesn't necessarily link with sort of digital innovation as such, I think it's a reflection maybe on the importance and the recognition of the importance of supporting colleagues, students in that way, when to help them to continue with their studies at college.
Mm-hmm. You said, I mean, we all agreed that the digital, you know, platforms that were available were a huge boost to everyone in the sector, particularly to the students. So could I just ask, as a follow-up to the previous discussion, why do you think there was such a fall-off in completion rates then if the remote learning element was embedded and in place and working successfully? Were there other factors clearly behind that, do you think?
I think it's hard to say that was the case everywhere. Even, you know, the representative from National Union of Students did say that it really depended on the experience and the environment that people were in, whether they were able to adapt to remote learning, and even echoing some of the points that Carolyn makes. Well, it would kind of depend on, you know, the circumstances that your household was in, whether you, even if you had remote learning access from your college, that whether you were able to access it, whether you had caring responsibilities, health issues, all of these factors would have contributed to some of the drop-off rates for course completion. Maybe it goes back to the earlier point that Hence the reason for colleges individually to know more, to have a better analysis of why people aren't completing their courses. That quality of data allows them to inform the choices they make about how they'll deliver in future. We would recognise, and we've touched on the report, that this wasn't an unknown issue in terms of digital access and digital exclusion. We talk about the investment the SFC made in supporting digital access, you know, £5.7 million, and then further £2.9 million to come to support digital access and learning. So there's funding there. I think it's to marry that up now with that analysis of what are the factors behind students that have challenges completing courses.
Do you think the colleges will keep the door open, Stephen, to continuing to deploy the online kind of environment? These are important lessons, I think, for us to learn and to hear about, because it's quite worrying that because of inclusion, exclusion issues, that students perhaps aren't able to exploit the capabilities of the digital world. So that's a big worry, and that will inevitably mean that more of them might leave, or there'll be a greater demand for them to return to the in-college setting to complete their courses. So we don't know which way it will go, but do you think the colleges will keep the door open to the online world and get the best of it that we can perhaps retain as we move forward?
I'll speculate, if I may. Actually, maybe the college sector themselves will be better placed to share with the committee, you know, what their intentions are around that. For me, it would depend on what kind of course, clearly. You know, there'll be many practical courses that will be delivered by Scotland's colleges that will require an in-person arrangement, but others less so. And therefore, there is that. All these competing variables, Mr. Coffey, around, you know, their estate, the you know, some of the financial pressures that they'll be facing, income opportunities for colleges. They have to marry up all of these things. But fundamentally, it is about the student experience, the outcomes that they get. And therefore, that kind of leads me to just the final point on this matter, is that it's vital that colleges are talking to their students about, you know, what experience that they want from learning. That data, that understanding of reasons for successful completion of courses and those that haven't completed the courses successfully to inform future strategy learning environments.
And the final point from me, convener, it's a follow through to Sharon's questioning there. There's a knock-on effect on the skills pool, isn't there? If there's more the students heading for university and less completing their courses, we're bound to have an impact. There's bound to be an impact on the skills pool available to us. And we heard about that throughout COVID, convener, that there were still opportunities there within certain sectors that were really struggling to recruit, particularly the hospitality sector. That was a huge problem that predated COVID, actually, but it got worse during there. So are we looking at a skills issue again, Auditor General, that should worry us and concern us, and what would your advice be for the sector to try to address that?
You're right, Mr. Coffey. You have heard about this, actually, and I'm again thinking back to the roundtable to hear from the Scotland's colleges about the role that some colleges are playing. Particularly, you mentioned some of the skills, but social care was the one that stuck in my mind about the acute pressures in that sector and how some colleges are responding to that, tailoring their courses to support that real skills gap that exists in the economy. That matters, and that, I think, that goes back to the overall role of the Funding Council and their prioritisation, government's response to the Funding Council's recommendations, therefore, about what are the principles, the priorities for the sector. Yes, it's about academic learning in and of itself, but it's also really very much about, you know, the contribution to economic requirements, and those are changing depending on the skills in different sectors. We make the point in the paper that, you know, we are keen to see progress in 2023 about what the Scotland's colleges sector will look like and what its priorities will be. That will be an important milestone.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. And I mean, do I discern from the briefing and what you've just said that there is a sufficient level of urgency on the part of the Scottish Funding Council and the Scottish Government to implement the recommendations that were made publicly in, I think, June 2021?
You can see from the paper, convener, we're looking to see that now move at pace so that the sector is clear on its role, its purpose, priorities. Some of that we'll get in May of next year, and then later on at the end of the summer, about the connections that the work that Scotland's colleges do to the overall national outcomes through the National Impact Framework. Again, these are really important milestones, that thread exists between public expenditure, outcomes, the role of individual public bodies. So looking to see progress on that over the course of the consultation that take place for the rest of this year through to the completion of those documents during 2023.
OK, thank you. I'm now going to bring in Craig Hoy, who's got some questions. Craig.
Thanks, good morning, Mr Boyle. I'd just like to just take up perhaps the convener's point in relation to the improvement plan and the expectations placed upon colleges. Then maybe just look at forward capital expenditure plans, and then just tie up a couple of loose ends in relation to the estate and the estate maintenance. But just first and foremost, I mean, obviously your briefing highlights a number of actions that the Scottish Government and the SFC must take to provide clarity and support for the long-term improvement plan in the sector. In your view at this stage, has the Scottish Government and the SFC provided enough guidance to ensure that colleges are fully aware of the expectations that are placed upon them and that are going to be placed upon them?
I think, morning, Mr. Hoy. As I mentioned to the convener, we're keen for this to move at pace. So it was last year that the SFC undertook their review of the college sector and made a number of recommendations to government. We'll now see the consultation over the course of the remainder of 2022, with the expectation that the Scottish Government's long-term purpose and principles for both the further education and higher education sector by May of next year, and then the prioritisation through the National Impact Framework. Clearly, the absence of these will influence the choices that individual colleges will make. So you can see that the language that we use about pace, the need for clarity, is evident in the paper. So we look forward to those documents and that process being completed. They feel really important. And also perhaps just touching on, as we refer to in the report, some of the progress around other aspects that have been looked at, regionalisation being one of the components of Scotland's colleges. We know that there's a work of one of your fellow parliamentary committees, the Education Skills Committee, is also looking at the success of regionalisation, but we're seeing some of that progress stalling where there have been regional boards. Glasgow in particular is still grappling with an alternative model. So that's not helpful in the current context. Looking to see clarity about successor arrangements, both in terms of effective governance, clarity of outcomes, impact, and that connection to the National Performance Framework. If I may, Mr. Hoy, just pause. Carol, I might want to come in and say a bit more on this matter.
Yeah, I think it is just a case of trying to move forward with that as swiftly as possible. Of course, having clarity about the operating context, the structure, the framework will all help with planning for the future and ensuring sustainability whilst continuing to deliver. But I'm not sure that there's much more to add to that, Steve. Thank you.
Obviously, your own evidence suggests the very tight financial arrangements that colleges will face. Are these expectations going to be realistic, do you think, or are we just going to add more pressure onto an already overstretched resource allocation?
The expectations have to marry up to a degree with the financial realities that Scotland's colleges are facing. We've talked already this morning about what the sector anticipated its overall financial sustainable position will be, deficits before returning to a smaller operating surplus. And we have real variables, of course, about the inflationary pressures that the economy is facing, as well as the wider fiscal context that Scotland is operating. All that has to be taken into account, of course, with the expectations or individual colleges. But ultimately, it is about the experience and the outcomes that Scotland students who are attending college get. So there's a real evolving picture, but those competing factors, of course, have to be married up, yes.
In your 2019 report, you recommended that the SFC and the Scottish Government agree and publish a medium-term capital investment strategy that sets out sector-wide priorities. This is yet to be published. Are you confident the work on this strategy is on track? And to your knowledge, when can we expect to see a finalised plan?
Mark might want to say a bit more about this in a moment or two, but as we note in the paper, there is an infrastructure strategy planned for the autumn of this year. So it's our understanding that that is in progress and will be published over the course of the next few months. Of course, we'll wait with interest and take a keen view on its contents as it relates to the overall structure, strategy and plans for the sector. Mark may wish to say a bit more.
Yeah, so we did make that recommendation back in 2019, and that was primarily on the back of some concerns we had about the underinvestment in the college estate. And you can see from Exhibit 6 of our report where, you know, we've quoted the estate survey that the Funding Council commissioned across the sector in 2017, which showed that there was a backlog maintenance issue of just over £360 million across a five-year period. That was just for backlog. You've obviously got the ongoing life cycle maintenance on top of that, and capital funding was falling well short of that. So we made that recommendation to make sure that there was clarity about what the priorities were for the sector, what was needed. Obviously, there's been a delay in reaching that. The past couple of years have impacted on progress with that. The past couple of years will have invariably changed the priorities for some of that, as we see different models of learning, different demands. And, you know, we have seen, you know, some new campuses being built. But, you know, there is still a real shortfall in terms of the capital funding that has been made available to maintain the estate. So we're hopeful that the infrastructure strategy that the Auditor General's just referred to there, which is due very shortly, will set out exactly how the estate is going to be developed going forward and how that's going to fit with the ambitions and expectations of the sector and with the models of delivery that are going to be expected to be in place going forward.
Obviously, there's going to be an issue of prioritisation, but it's evident that in terms of backlog maintenance, there is a significant shortfall. Also, moving forward, there is obviously the requirement to deal with net zero to make sure that the estate is meeting those targets. So are you concerned that the funding shortfall, the capital funding shortfall presently, both historically and moving forward, could to some extent undermine the delivery of education through the safety of the estate? And how concerned would you be that those big CapEx expenditures that are required to meet the net zero target may not be achievable given the ongoing tight framework that we see throughout the sector?
I think we need to wait to see the contents of the strategy in the autumn before passing any judgment. And we've not had any insight into it. Clearly, we would absolutely expect both backlog maintenance, net zero expectations. And also think to refer again to the resource spending review, it's very clear that the future of the estate across all public bodies is part of the government's thinking about, you know, their contribution to net zero and fiscal sustainability across the piece. So we expect all of that will be covered in the infrastructure strategy. And at that point, as part of our work on colleges in the year ahead, and individual colleges for that matter, to take a view on what that means for their operations.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. And I've really just got one final question to put to you, and it's something you've already alluded to, which is the fact that the Parliament's Education, Children and Young People Committee is conducting its own inquiry into the regionalisation, the restructuring of the college sector. And it was merely to ask whether you have or you will be giving evidence to that committee.
So we understand that the committee's evidence taking has now concluded, convener, at the beginning of May. So we are awaiting their conclusion and their findings, and I think it'll be a very helpful contribution, especially as we've mentioned already, the government themselves are looking at the role of the sector, priorities, principles, and how that connects with the national outcomes. We look forward to reading that, and of course we'll factor that into our work for the year ahead.
Thank you. Because again, we've had discussions before, I think, in the context of the Section 22 report into South Lanarkshire College about, for example, what's the point of regional boards? And, you know, is the structure in the sector maybe too top-heavy with the Scottish Funding Council, regional boards, college boards, principals slash now principals slash CEOs, as many of them describe themselves, vice principals, assistant principals, and so on. So, I mean, there are some, I think, quite big questions there, aren't there, around whether the management governance of the sector is as effective as it could be.
There are real fundamentals there, Convener, absolutely. And as we mentioned in the report, that some of the college regional boards themselves have struggled to come up with alternatives whilst recognising that the status quo is less than satisfactory in dealing with all of those issues. I think from our perspective, it's helpful, therefore, that the Education Committee has embarked upon this review of regionalisation. So keenly await the recommendations from that report and anticipate that that will inform some of the government's own plans for this, the future of the sector.
Well, thank you very much indeed. I think that concludes our questions for this morning, but it does raise some quite important issues, as I said earlier, both about the financial state of the colleges sector in Scotland in 2022 and also whether or not it's delivering the outcomes we all want to see for the students that are entering it. Auditor General, can I thank you? Can I thank Mark McCabe and Carolyn McLeod for your evidence this morning? It's been very helpful, and we shall consider our next steps. But at that point, I'd like to close the public part of this morning's committee meeting. Thank you.